speak. Two means you speak.
Fellow Toastmasters, it happened this month, 20 years ago. A young girl, 15 years old, took the public phone at the Kinabalu Park and shouted over the phone, "Papa, Papa, I made it! We made it!" It was my daughter. After her Form 3 exams, she had gone with a group of her school friends, accompanied by two teachers, and they had scaled Gunung Kinabalu, the highest peak in Southeast Asia. Her excitement came all the way through the telephone line from Kinabalu. Not just the excitement, the exaltation that she was going through, the exuberance of her spirit, and the total excitement that she felt for having conquered this place. And as I received the news, a strong vibration went through me. And I said to myself, if my daughter can do it, I too want to do it. In fact, I've been thinking of climbing Kinabalu for many years, just like my daughter. The difference was, she acted on it, I was still thinking about it. Dr. Napoleon Hill says, the reality of a thought manifesting into action depends very much on the frequency of the thought as well as the intensity of the thought. I realized that the frequency was there, but I had not put in the intensity. And yet, Dr. Hill said, whatever the mind of man can conceive plus believe, the mind of man can achieve. And therefore, I kept my thoughts alive. The vibration continued until eventually it did manifest. It was 7 years ago. I had completed a success program in Napoleon Hill Associates. And as a challenge for having completed that Science of Success program, I decided that I will climb Kinabalu myself. My vibrations were so strong that it also attracted 7 others to join me. It was much later that I realized that what had inspired them was simply this: if Singham can do it, one lady who joined our group had a very simple formula. She said, I am going to climb this mountain and all I have to do is keep one step in front of Singham. He goes to the top, I will also be there. You see, 7 years ago, I was like this. And therefore, although I was mentally and spiritually ready, but physically and physiologically, I was not. But I booked the flight. I booked the flight and all 8 of us were there in Kinabalu Park in May. And then we climbed. It was 14,000 feet to the peak. And there was a rest area called Laban Ratha at 10,000 feet. Somehow, I managed it. I was leading the pack all the way from the rear. You have heard of the rear guard, right? And therefore, as the leader and as a servant leader, I had to be at the back to make sure that they all reached there. After the rest in Laban Ratha, were setting out once more to reach the peak. And there was a simple reason why we had to leave Labanrata at 4 a.m. The reason was we had to be at the peak before sunrise to see the sun rise. But there was a beautiful moment at that time, and that was being the eve of Vesak Day, the moon was shining in all its splendor. And the very special phenomenon on Vesak Day is that is the time of the year the moon is closest to the earth. And therefore, it was virtually twice its size. And I was up there at the mountain, and the moon was rising at the horizon. It was below me. And I felt that if I took a few steps back and ran and jumped, I could jump over the moon. But tragedy struck. I had a cramp. A muscle cramp came. Usually when cramps come, on a scale of 1 to 10, it's like 2 or 3. That day, it was at 12. It was excruciating. What do I do? I'm up there at the 12,000 feet. Another 2,000 feet to the peak. But another 12,000 feet to the base. So I struggled. I limped along. And I tried to shift my weight so that it wouldn't be there. But you know, with so much of weight, it's very difficult to shift it. And then the magic happened. The cramp went away. It just disappeared. And as I continued to walk, suddenly it happened in the other leg. Again, I had no other choice but to keep walking. And then it disappeared. And it happened frequently. My toes got cramped. But I just kept walking. And then, on top of the mountain, at 13,000 feet, I realized one thing Dr. Napoleon Hill had not taught me. And that is, in order to succeed, if you have no option to fail, then surely you will succeed. Think about it. Why do we often let go of our dreams? Because we have an option to let go of the dream. But when you're up there and you have no other choice but to keep moving forward, when your only option is to succeed, then surely you will succeed. Let us keep this in mind, because I have this firmly entrenched in me for the rest of my life. Thank you.